hopefully everyone's here for Math 104. It's called Mathematical Analysis, or Introduction to Mathematical Analysis, or something like this. It's calculus. You don't know this, but you'll see it's calculus. Basically, I'll get into what the course is about, but this is the first section. There is another section, and as you might have already heard, I'm working with the other instructor to try to keep our classes, at least homework-wise, in the same ballpark. So that means not only can you work with anyone in this room, but you can technically work with anyone in the other class, too, if you want to help. And in principle, that also means you could go to his lecture on a day you missed, though we're not, like, syncing our lectures. We're just sort of saying, cover this material this week, and so we're going to cover that material how either of us feels like doing it, and with whatever examples he or I feel like doing. And at the end of the day, what I do in this class is more important than this class. Okay? So, I mean, I'm not saying just because you want to get up at noon so you go to the 2 o'clock class, be aware. But should you have, like, some emergency or for instance, should you have your best friend in the other class, you feel free to work with them on homework. We'll get to that. My name is Ivan Ventura. You can call me Ivan. I don't have a title yet. Hopefully in a year I'll have a title, but that's still probably make you call me Ivan. My email is ivanventura@math.com. My office is at 1039 Evans. So a bit about me. So I guess I'm now a veteran of the Berkeley Math Program. I mean, I started doing this a couple years ago, but so I've been here for 4 years. I probably shouldn't say this. I know it's jinxing, but hopefully I'll be done next May. Have like a cool PhD and get the cool hood at graduation. Look better than people for some reason. But anyways, yeah. So I actually do partial differential equations, which is called analysis. I actually do analysis for a living. This is the first time they've actually given me a course that like is exactly what I do, and so I really do love this course, but There's things that are interesting about it. So let's see what's on the syllabus to make sure I say everything. Right, so I should probably put my office hours on the board so that everyone sees them on the board even though they're on a piece of paper. So my office hours, this is technically tentative. Because I can imagine somebody is taking let's say a course right at 12, and these would be like the worst possible office hours you could have. And if that's the case, please email me and I'll change them. So these might change. For right now, office hours are right after this class on Tuesday and Thursday, and for 2 hours on Thursday. And the reason for this is, as you'll see in a second, is homework is going to be due every Monday. So Thursday, since we don't have class Friday, is the last day you really have to see me. And then the reason, and I've already had this issue before, since we don't have class Friday, but I know there's a few of you that commute in, I'm not going to have office hours Friday. Because it's not fair to the people who are commuting in. Because, you know, they're here already 4 days a week, make the office hours the same days they're already here. Okay? But these are the tentative office hours. If these don't work for you, please email. And we'll gladly work that out. Right, so this course, where should I start? Let's talk about this one. This is literally the course where we're going to prove that all that stuff you did in calculus and you hated doing in calculus actually works. This is the course where we're going to go through all those theorems you saw and prove them and make everything concrete, like everything you've done. I'm going to ask this more formally, but just out of curiosity, how many of you have taken like either 110 or 113, or by that, or also if you're not from here, like an abstract algebra or a proof-based linear algebra course? Okay, some of you. Great. That'll help me a bit, but I'll ask for this a little nicer in a second, and I'll show you how. The reason I bring this up is 113 and 110 are very nice courses. I've taught both of them. I really enjoy teaching them. The material is really great. But this course is a little different than those for one reason. You know, in like linear algebra, so everyone's taken at least like lower division linear algebra, right, where you like have to do all these horrible matrix reductions about 15 times a day for a month or something, I don't know. But that in those classes, like, if I ask something like, you know, prove this is linearly independent, everyone knows where to start that proof. That proof is very, like, after a bit of practice, there's just one way to start that proof. And that really makes things in proofs in those classes a little nicer. And abstract algebra is the same, but a lot of you probably haven't taken it. I'm not going to give examples for it. This course is a little different. Me and my friend last night went to grab a beer as a last hurrah before, because he's teaching also right now as we speak. And I was telling him the reason I'm terrified about teaching this course is because I can give you guys a proof where I can give you a problem where the proof is actually extremely easy. But the trick is sort of from out of nowhere. Or rather, I can give you 15 different problems on the same material of equal difficulty, which have all different techniques to prove it. So that sounds terrifying, but it also means that there's a little bit more, there's more to learn from taking this course. My goal will be to just, I'm going to try to emphasize that today, just give you an example of a very simple thing that the proof is sort of, that'll basically characterize some of the big things about analysis proofs that are different. But we'll get to that in a minute. I want to still talk about a few more things. So I've chosen this book, very pretty, Walter Rudin's Principle of Mathematical Analysis to teach this course. The main reason I chose this is both me and, or Alex and I chose it. We chose it because both of us learned out of this book. So, it worked for us. So that's the only book we know, like, inside out, because at one point we had to suffer. But this book isn't the easiest book in the world. And the reason for that is that Walter Rudin, is a brilliant mathematician, and often thinks things are obvious. So he just says, he doesn't say it's obvious. He's actually very courteous. If he was, 20 years younger and he wrote the book, he would say everything was obvious in the book. And it was stupid. No, he doesn't say it's obvious. He just, proceeds. You guys understood everything about every step. And something that, I know it helps a lot of people. One of the things you do, I'm expecting you to read the book. This week we plan on covering at least, hopefully by Wednesday through chapter one. I expect, by Wednesday, chapter one mostly finished. I may bleed into Thursday, depending on how you guys are dealing with my presentation and material. Right? But I have an idea what we're trying to cover. But for instance, he gives a proof. There'll be a lot of steps missing. And it's not that the steps are like he's being lazy or something. It's just to him, he sees that he can move on. And he does. And sometimes it's not even that it's missing. He just doesn't point out why this step is taken care of. So one of the things I find really useful when you're reading this book is, let's say I'm reading this proof, and I see, wait, there's something missing. I try to figure out why it's missing, and then maybe I write it in on my margin. Oh, this is true because, and I put it in. This is probably one of the few books this is the only book I've ever taught out of where literally it's as important to write in notes to your book as it is to read the book itself. Because, I'm telling you, when I was preparing this lecture this weekend, there were a couple proofs, I'm like, well, this just is, why doesn't he say this? And I had to actually sit down and think about it for a couple of minutes and then write down why it was. And so one of the things I will try to do in class when I cover proofs from Rudin is give all the steps or lay out everything in a nicer, longer way than it is. So one of the things you'll learn also is that if it takes Rudin half a page to prove something, it means it's pretty intense. Mm-hmm. Right? Because he leaves out all the steps anyway. It would take, a mere mortal several pages to prove this stuff. Whatever. But I'm telling you this now because this book is extremely good. The other thing he does, but I like it at this level, is he does everything in best described nauseating generality. He'll want to say this is true for R, but he'll say something like this is true for all ordered fields or something stupid like R. He'll generalize to the most general assumptions you can make for every theorem, which is great once you know everything. And right now it's a nice way to get used to the material in my opinion, especially when we get to chapter two. Chapter two is literally 110, the material covered in 110, 113, and 104. Chapter 2 of this book is probably my favorite single chapter because it's very pretty. And everything's sort of it's very abstract, but it's also sort of mystical, and then suddenly it's concrete. And then suddenly, we'll get to that. I don't need to get into chapter 2. Alright, cool. So, next thing I have to say, probably, because that's the textbook, great. So there's going to be homework, there's going to be quizzes, there's going to be a midterm, and there's going to be a final. And those are the only things that are going to affect your grade. This is something because I always give myself, as part of the homework grade, participation. This doesn't necessarily mean you have to come and raise your hand and say something every day, but I think especially for this book, it's important for you guys to be in class. I'm never going to take attendance, but last summer, I had a student who would show up once a week and spend that whole section asking questions that we covered the previous day. And I'm really annoyed. So by participation, I mean, at least keep up with the course. And ask questions. I'll love that. I'm going to be giving worksheets at times. Work on those with your neighbors. That's important. But I'm never going to mark you down for it unless you literally are not being a good citizen. Right? It's on there somewhere, I think, in the grade.